Hi, good afternoon. Welcome to another episode of the Jenna Lee Show. I'm Jenny Long.
And I'm Celie Clark.
And we are
Jenna Lee.
Good job.
I know, we're like, I mean, we're going to be pros by the time this is over.
Yeah, we're getting it. We're getting it. We have some very, very, very special guests with us here this afternoon. We are so excited to hear from them. So we're going to show you who they are here in just a minute. We can see Holly dancing back there. Well, we have with us this afternoon Holly Clark and Lisa Highfill, and we are so excited to hear what they have to say about HyperDocs. So this is something new for Celie and I, and we, well, we have the book. So I was telling them when we get some downtime, we have all of their books and we're so excited and we just want to dive into them, but just really, you know, just kind of tear it apart, but have the time. So that's on my to-do list. So I'm super excited about that, but we are excited to hear from them, and I'm going to give them some time to go ahead and introduce themselves. So, Holly, you want to go ahead and get started, and then we'll pass it on to Lisa and just tell us a little bit about who you are and why you guys are so amazing.
So thank you, and thanks for having me. And I'm Holly. I live in San Diego, so I'm pretty happy all the time because the beach is just right around the corner, and I love being able to see that. But I also am one of the co-authors of the Microsoft Infused Classroom. So for your audience, that might sound familiar, which is really based around pedagogy. So what we tried to do with that book, I think if people open it, they think it might be like tools, but it's not. You have to read it. You have to say, oh, you want to do formative assessment? Well, here are some great tools you can use and how to use them. And so it's kind of a new concept for the Microsoft crowd. So I can't wait for people to catch on to that part of it, that it's, if you read through it, it's about pedagogy. And I'm super excited to be part of this Microsoft sort of crowd now because I want to introduce all of you to something that has changed my life. And that change came from the person sitting next to me. And her name is Lisa Highfill. We're both Google certified innovators. And so some of the stuff that we're gonna talk about, the Google people took it like and ran with it, but there's no reason it can't be done. And Microsoft did it because it's so powerful. So I'm gonna let Lisa explain who she is and a little bit about this. And I'll bring in the Microsoft component of it as we speak.
Perfect. Thank you, Holly, and thanks so much for having me on your show. I am Lisa Highfill, and I am a tech integration coach in Pleasanton Unified School District, which is about 40 minutes east of San Francisco. And so it's a little chilly here today. I've got my long sleeves back on today. I was a fifth grade teacher for 20 years in the classroom. And so I've been a coach now for the last, this is my seventh year as a coach. And come to find out, I love to work with adults. It's been a nice shift from those 10-year-olds. But it's amazing how similar we are. We're the same learners, we're just taller. It was such an amazing opportunity because this HyperDoc concept started when Sarah and Kelly, Sarah Landis and Kelly Hilton, my co-authors, we were all fifth grade teachers in the same district. And we were all collaborating together around, we were finally getting devices in the classroom with for students we had wanted so bad to move away from labs, and we were getting them in the classroom and they were for testing. We're like, what? No, we cannot waste this investment and just do it once a year for testing, you know, purposes. But we were noticing that teachers were getting these computers in their classroom and were really lost on what do I do with them now? And so they would write up long URLs on the board and say, all right, kids, I want you to go here and try this website. Now, granted, this is back, you know, like 2010. So, okay, things have changed since then. We get that. That's when we were starting this work, 2010, 2011. And saying that, how can we shift really good instructional practices into the digital realm? And so we came up with HyperDocs. So we came up with the name. It was not, you know, something that we necessarily wanted to stick. It just happened to stick. A doc, it does not mean that it has to be on a doc. A HyperDoc is actually hyper meaning live, a live document that can be altered or changed, and doc stands for document. We really felt that it was device agnostic, and we've always felt that way, but we all work in a Google Apps for Education district. So you tend to work around what tools you have. And so we hope to really spread that information, and I'd love to share with you a little more about what a HyperDoc is and how it's not about that tool, not about that Google product. That can be a misnomer. So I have some slides for you I'd love to share. And this is a HyperDoc. This is one that I've made. It's actually packaged on a document. So it is packaged. So you can transfer that knowledge to any kind of a document you want to package it on. The key to this is that it has lesson design built into it. And that's really the important part. And what I mean by lesson design is I'm sorry, I'm getting all teachery back to your credential program here and talk about cycles of learning. And very quickly, when I first started teaching, I was all about this cycle of learning. I would explain the concept first, and then the knowledge, I'd have the kids apply that knowledge in homework, and then I would have them assess. So it was that cycle. It was like lecture, homework, test. So we are used to that. And sometimes we can get really stuck in that. Well, when we developed these, we wanted to improve pedagogy at the same time as teaching teachers how to use their technology really well. So I was really influenced by Ramzi Mousallem and his work around cycles of learning and about shifting the cycle to explore first, then explain, then apply. And this is what we based all of our work on, is getting kids to explore content. Then we get into the explanation of the content, then the application of that knowledge. And it's not just practice, not just answering a bunch of math problems. It's actually authentic application. And so I like to, we have this great sandwich place called Witch Witch. I don't know if you guys have ever heard of Witch Witch.
Love it.
Yeah, so I'll miss it.
I love that place. This reminds me of HyperDocs, because you have to make all these decisions when you're designing lessons for your students. You have all these choices to make. And granted, I'm not choosing what dressing or what cheese to put on. It's a series of decisions to make through this digital lesson. And so you can see here we have the engage, the explore portion, and the explain portion, and then the apply portion. I included the engage in this one because it's really great to launch your kids with an engage. So this is a document, and all of the learning that I want them to do is packaged right here in one spot, one location. So if I'm not there, or in this new remote learning situation, they can make sense and go through this cycle of learning and actually complete this application down here with some, you know, blended learning when we were in the classroom for sure, but some offline, some online, and they can make meaning, but it's really meaningful tasks is the most important part. It's not a checklist of assignments just to get through. This really asks them, because I've got this pedagogy in here with the explore, I want them to understand what a manifesto is before I explain what a manifesto is. So it walks them through. There are some links on here for them to post a line of what it means to you in this video. So they watch a video, they post their line, what it means to them, and they respond to each other in there. It's that built-in collaboration, that communication, that critical thinking piece is in here. And then, of course, the creating piece is so important. So this is our major template that is a part. This is really the structure of our whole book. And this is, again, when I say that this can be packaged on anything. I'm so happy that you have me on your show today, because while we tend to talk in the language of Google Docs, I'm hoping other people can see that this template can be used in any platform.
Mm-hmm. And if I may,
yes.
This template is made in Google Docs. And if you go to a Google Doc, and I have a video of it on my website, that you just go up to File, and then you go Download as a Word doc, and it becomes, and it stays the same, and it is a Word doc, and it goes into your OneDrive. And you can even place it if you're good enough you can put it in OneNote and make a dot, like a binder mm-hmm. or a section of all of your HyperDocs. Mm-hmm. So it's not about a Google Doc. It just started on a Google Doc.
Yeah, yeah. And again, this is our large template, but you see at the heart of it is explore, explain, apply again. And having that template really guides the instruction. So as we're in this remote situation, how do teachers move from assigning to really designing instructional content? And so we're finding that this template, it just walks them through it. They can understand what should go in each portion. Now I wanna show you this template. This looks very different, but it's the same template. And of course I have to add some color and some graphics. The kids don't care about the term explore, explain, apply. I know what they are. I built in the pedagogy, but this is a unit actually. This is a 2-week unit packaged here. So I'm talking to teachers as a coach in my district and saying that if we are going to a blended model next year, maybe a hybrid, I have no idea what we're doing, but if we were in class some days and we were remote other days, wouldn't this be great to have this unit packaged like this so kids could go and access it all in one location? Those with executive functioning struggles, it's not like I've got multiple docs that I'm searching for, like, where's the assignment? Where's the template? How do I turn this in? It is all right here and labeled. I try to keep my instructions very minimal, yet to allow kids to think. I try not to overteach on these, but everywhere you see blue, I've linked up resources to support all learners on this.
So Lisa, I want to interrupt and talk Microsoft here for a second.
Yes.
So Microsoft has Teams, and anyone watching probably uses Teams. And in Teams, they have a place called Tabs. And you can go to a tab, put in website, and put the link to this doc, and it would just sit as a tab inside of your Teams so kids can access it and aren't trying to find it, can't remember where it is. And that's something unique to Microsoft Teams and Microsoft that makes this even like work better in the Microsoft environment.
Yeah, I'm finding in lots of different environments, people were passing out, you know, I think about the Google Classroom environment, and they were just putting into the stream assignment after assignment. And it was really a struggle to try to find what goes with what, where was that, I can't find it. And a HyperDoc, if I had to sum it up, it's a package, and you package that pedagogy so they can clearly walk through this. Now, this is packaged on a doc, but we, I guess I should say too, and I'm not going to leave this for y'all to read. It's a lot of reading, but we purposely packaged this to meet the needs of learners. This is probably a discussion for another day because there's so much intention built in here that what do we do for our language learners? What do we do for students who have that executive functioning issues anyway? So that's a whole other day. But okay, I need my Microsoft translator here, Holly.
Yes.
We don't always package on docs. This is slides.
Or PowerPoint.
PowerPoint.
Situation, you go to file, download as a PowerPoint. It literally comes up exactly the same with all the backgrounds, with everything. And then we all know, Lisa doesn't know, that PowerPoint is a bit more powerful
than
Google Slides. And, you know, so now you bring it in and you could screen record on top of it. And you can do all these things.
Yes. Oh, my gosh.
And with live presentations, too, where the students can get the presentation on their device and use Translator.
Oh, my gosh. I mean,
Immersive Reader.
Immersive Reader is just the best, because one of the issues we're having is, like, when you give this to a first grader or a kindergartner, they can't read these directions. And so I am just always challenged. How do I get students to be able to understand how to do this assignment? How do I package on here lots of choice? This is for elementary. You can see how fun. Don't you want to click in here and play? And try this out. And so it kind of goes through. This was my explore, explore, and then the explain, and then the apply. And it just walks through what you're supposed to do with this. And then the workflow is built in, the how to turn it in. And so you can design this however you wish. It's got lots of opportunity. You are in the seat of being the designer. Now, I wanted to just show this one. I didn't even tell Holly I was going here. But it is truly device agnostic, because I have teachers all the time who package on things like ThingLink. or yeah, I mean, we are starting to build them on Wakelet. We're building them all over the place. Right, yeah. This is
my mindset thinking Wakelet, like this is perfect for Wakelet. Oh, yeah. Like, put it all in a Wakelet and you got it right there, all in one package.
Or Genially, because Genially allows you to make the images clickable as well, or Buncee. I mean, whatever format people are using.
Great. So this is
on Buncee,
Go ahead. Now imagine kindergartners. They don't know this is Explore, and this is a little brain pop video about US symbols. And then here's the Explain. And this is what we did all together as a class because they didn't know the difference between country and state. So we had to go through that a little bit. And then going through, and this was, you know, I could teach that lesson, but the key is the kids who needed to come back and say, how many stripes are red? How many stripes are white? They could come back and double check this because in the apply portion, they went to ABCA and they painted their own flag. And so Explore, Explain, Apply. This is what it looks like at kindergarten. And so it's all about building in that design. Oh, I don't want to get into...
If I can really quick, Lisa, it's packaging too, because I was in a virtual summit the other day and someone had these ideas of things that kids could do in a PBL class. And they had a dock that was a table that was white that had the name of the thing and then a link. And although it is just a dock with links in that particular instance, which a HyperDoc is not, it has a full lesson design in it. It was so boring. And I have to be honest, I took a picture and sent it to my friend Tanya and said, who's still doing this? Like, you could package it in the way that you just saw.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and that's the idea, is that how do we and spark curiosity? How do we get them to engage in these lessons without making it as a task that they have to do? I want to change the way kids learn by designing these. And I'm constantly saying that. If you could be the designer of a lesson that changes the way you deliver instruction and it changes the way kids experience learning, where they have the ability to take ownership and build that like efficacy for their learning, where they could mess up and they have choice, it kind of brings it all together. So that's why I'm really excited to be with you today, because I think that, you know, we never wanted to be just Google Docs people. It's really about lesson design, digital lesson design.
And I love that lesson cycle. Yeah. I'm like, that is amazing.
Yeah, and I also love that you make it graphically appealing, like Holly was talking about. Like, that's one of my biggest things is through distance learning, our kiddos have to read content galore, more than they've ever had to read before, and putting it in a visually, you know, aesthetic way that students can quickly see it, understand, and know what they need to do is just, it's brilliant. It's such a great way to use the lesson cycle while also making it appealing and interesting for students.
Yeah. Thank you so much for bringing that up. You know, we tried, when we were developing these, my children were in high school. And so they would come down and we would say, okay, which one would you rather do, this one or this one? You know, and we'd show them. And the first thing they would say is they would pick the one that was colorful. Because it didn't look as boring. And then they picked the one that had the least amount of writing on it. Because they thought it was less work. Like, okay, it's the same work. I just packaged it differently.
Exactly.
And so it's about that design theory and about how can we look at something and quickly make sense of this chunked information and what is expected of me. And then how can I quickly go back and find information within that lesson that I need in order to move forward. Yeah, it's a big part of that design aspect.
And even thinking about accessibility, like think about all the ways you can build an accessibility with HyperDocs within Microsoft platform.
Yes.
I mean, so many options available for you in that way. So I love that.
I want to bring up one other point that Lisa's talked about, but she kind of went over it quickly, is that so you can create a doc with links, and I hope you're going to show a multimedia tech set so that our viewers can see the difference. But inside of a HyperDoc, I want you to think about the four C's being in there. So while you're designing this lesson, it has a time where kids communicate what they're learning. They collaborate with another kid somehow. They create something from it, and they're critically thinking. So you're thinking as you're making one of these, where am I embedding these places where those elements can be? And so that's what makes it different than a doc with links, which would be a resource doc where kids go out and consume, which is mm-hmm. not bad. We're going to show you some amazing examples of that. Mm-hmm. But and this is what she's going to do right now. This is I die for these.
Yeah.
These are not hyperdocs.
So, you know, Jenny, you brought up a really good point about that cycle of learning and starting with the explore first. So this is not a hyperdoc. This is a multimedia tech set. And this is the ultimate explore tool. So I made this one. We had a unit coming up and we were really trying to help kids explore what is a refugee without us telling them, without us explaining it to them. Now, if I stood up and did a lecture first, like just ran through the slides and said, this is what a refugee is, and I just sat and explained it all, I know that it would go in one ear and out the other. It's such passive learning for them. But instead, what if you took that slide presentation and stuck it in this tech set and let them explore and make them actively engage mm-hmm. with thinking and then have them tell you what they think? What are your questions? What are your thoughts? What are your opinions now? And then when you get to the explain portion of that lesson, now you know where your students are at because you did your first formative assessment, your first check-in. And if they're kind of at some high levels of thinking around that concept, you can elevate your lesson then and move forward with it. But if there's a lot of misunderstanding about what a refugee is, that is where you begin your lesson. Instead of just doing this blanket talk, let me tell you, and then you take notes on what I said, and then, you know, it's just... it's too passive of learning. Where this, we give these, we build them again on a doc. It's just a table. We've just included images, visually appealing. We tried to do it with the bold words are actually DOK words. They're verbs and they're varied from level 1 to level 4. But most importantly, I know some people are like, well, that doesn't mean anything. What means something is the item we put in there. So we want some high level thinking items that students can choose what to go to. We want them to have choice. I would never require every student to do every link on here. It's sort of like step back and, you know, stop being so controlling with your lesson and see where they go. You know, mm-hmm. let them be curious, you know, let them have something to be curious about. Right, Holly? I mean, like, if we want to inspire curiosity in kids, you've got to give them something to be curious about. And so every once in a while, I'll be like, oh, my gosh, did you guys see that? The link in the top right corner, you have to check that out tomorrow if you haven't seen that, because I spent like the whole time on that link, and I mm-hmm. didn't get to any other links. And so some kids will do that. And then we have them tell us all they know about it. Now, the key to this, though, is that this we can do this in a couple different ways. I've also done tech sets that look like this. If I want students to respond to each of the links, we build a table like this. Now, each student would have their own copy. If I wanted to build background knowledge before we read this book, I would build a, and this one is not as graphic. There's not as much many images, but it's the book trailer. We can have the author's website. We can have some history about South Sudan. We can, there's a lot of things before you launch a book that can build that background knowledge. And that's the key to the explore part. Build mm-hmm. background knowledge so that when you do get to the explanation of your lesson, they have this schema for what you're talking about. Instead mm-hmm. of like being in the dark or being confused.
So Mike Tolson had me read a book, and we do a little book exchange often. And I was reading The Knowledge Gap, which I don't agree with pretty much everything this person says inside of the book. But what she said is that we're missing in the American education system the background knowledge, because kids can't comprehend what if we just go into talking about farm animals and you're talking to a kid who lives in San Diego, they are like, I kind of think I know what a farm animal is. Mm-hmm. So this gives that, what you were saying, schemata to help them comprehend better. And then mm-hmm. You saw me do this maybe for a second. I don't know what you can see and not see, but someone put in the chat, Sarah, do you think that some subjects lend themselves to multimedia tech sets more than others? I teach high school biology, and this can be hard at times. And I kind of was like, oh, I'm working with a school in Maine right now. And well, we just finished because it was a year-long engagement, but the best HyperDocs that we did came from the high school AP biology class.
Oh, that's awesome.
And every time she would come on, because we had these monthly meetings, she would showcase what she was doing. And I literally one time cried. It was so good.
Yeah.
She said, Holly, these took me a lot of time to make, but once I got
it. Once you have it.
Mm-hmm. Incredible. So it kind of made me think to myself, I'm doing this thing with Q and Microsoft where I'm doing some remote learning webinars, and I'm going to focus in on bringing Microsoft people over to HyperDocs and giving them that pedagogy that helps them build it correctly, because even my Google friends aren't always building it correctly. And maybe I need to have her on, because like to see those examples, it's something you do think like, oh, it's easy to put the outsiders in there. And maybe it is.
I think that how do you know what to create with? How do you, it's the things, to me, it's the lessons I really want to stick are what I build tech sets in HyperDocs with, because I know that they are designed for all, to meet all students' needs, and it's something they can refer back to. So if I really want a lesson to be sticky and something that they don't forget, I definitely build a HyperDoc around it. I brought this one back up, and I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, you're good. I was just going to say, Holly mentioned it earlier, but one of the things about building that anticipatory set or that grabbing that background knowledge is communication within it. And I love the idea of putting this in teams and building that communication where students can just communicate and figuring it out together and really build on each other's background knowledge and maybe even make a connection where I had no idea to make that connection.
Right. Well, and this project is my good idea project, and I wanted kids to come up with clever ideas. And so I asked them, what layers of clever do you see happening? And I started with that Engage video about hosting bees on rooftops in San Francisco. It was a news story. And then I started collecting YouTube videos that I thought were really clever ideas. And so there's probably 50 videos on there. The kids sat together and just started going through these videos. I'm like, oh my God, I love that. Oh, that's inspiring. And they're like, I could make that. I could do that. And so looking at problem solution, and then we started getting into research and evaluating websites and credibility. I mean, this is a really hefty unit that we were accomplishing here. And then they came up with their own.
It looked like it.
I know.
You know what I'm saying?
Right. Now, I do want to share before we run out of time as well that, and I can stop screen sharing, but one key to these that I definitely have to say is that if they seem like a lot of work to make, we created Teachers Give Teachers to go alongside with this. Now, that's a different name than the other company. And it's where these are open source. We want HyperDocs to always remain free open source documents that can be copied. Then teachers can make their own edits and revisions to meet their own standards, their own needs, or their own goals as they should be. We want them to be thinking about the students in front of them, not just finding a good digital worksheet that would work and then hand it out. So that's kind of the key, is that you find it, you make a copy of it, and you edit for the needs of the kids in front of you. And that's really important.
Do it for the colors. And I just liked the color scheme. And I did, it was like history, and I put in an English thing into it.
Yeah.
I just wanted that part of it.
Yeah. So.
All right. And I'm putting that link up now. I want to make sure I got the right one. Is that the hyperdocs.co?
Yes. That is our brand new. We just launched our academy. So if you'd like to learn more how to make these, and most importantly, how to teach with them.
For free, that's, by the way.
Yeah, for free. You can go and join our academy. We have online courses right now that we just launched. For remote learning, we have a lot that are specific to remote learning, and then how to find a bunch of HyperDocs, and then how do you remix them and edit them for remote time, because it's different than if I were to deliver this in the classroom. So we talk a lot about that.
And I apologize. And I'm trying to take that then and then just remind the Microsoft users, okay, cool, you found some good ones. Let's go to File, make a copy. Let's do it in a PowerPoint or Microsoft Word. And then talk about some of the great tools on top of that Microsoft has.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's great. I love that you shared that, because, you know, just having something to start with, you know, that template, to give you some ideas. I think it's fabulous. So I think we have some amazing. Mike says awesome. And I know we have this is so useful. Thank you for sharing. So definitely some great feedback for sure.
We have a big, crazy HyperDoc Facebook group as well. Yeah. And if anyone wants to talk more, it is quite the community. If you just search HyperDocs in Facebook, you can join in the conversation there, and people are sharing and they're saying, this didn't work for me. I would love to see Microsoft educators in there. Please come in and start chatting, because we have teachers in there that really need to hear from you, especially the Microsoft experts. Come in and please, we want to see your HyperDocs and have them shared with teachers, give teachers. I would love to highlight the experts in Microsoft, and we'd have you on our show to celebrate the way you're designing using Microsoft tools. So that would be amazing.
I love that. I think, you know, like Jenny and I are both Microsoft, and so we didn't really understand what HyperDoc were or what the big hype was or why we could use them. And when Holly would talk about them, we were like, links, right? Like, putting right. links in the page. And so this has like completely opened our eyes and made us really look at, you know, it really is the lesson cycle and how important it is when building out content. And I love that, from being able to have a quick spot, only one place to go and build a built-in within our tool. So
Well, and it kind of goes along, like when you mentioned putting the document as a top tab, that's exactly what we've been doing with our teachers, because they create a one pager for the week for the students. And so they'll have, you know, what they're supposed to do for ELA and math, and it has all the links built into it. So it's a one pager of links, but I love incorporating that lesson cycle so that it's that process and going through that, so that, I mean, I know where Slee's going after this. We're going to be building some.
And also, I am hacking it a little bit, and I'll be doing this through this Microsoft Q thing when I'm going to do like four or five things around the Microsoft Educator and HyperDocs. But so you also want to use it to differentiate, and you might want to take different ones. And if you put it that tab, then you have the same one. So we're hacking it and putting it into channels. And then in the channel, we're going up to the SharePoint and changing the sharing permissions. And so those kids can't mess with whatever, and other kids can get to and actually, I'm kind of saying that wrong, but using the channel scenario,
private, yeah.
There's so much you need to teach me. I need to learn all of this, so I can't wait to see what you're creating. One key, though, is that I would never, in my weekly plan for remote learning, I would never make all HyperDocs for it. It's too much. And so I would do maybe one a week, and maybe in one subject. And I'm trying to help our teachers in our district right now think in terms of, what can you offload to remote learning? How can you package a unit like that Good Idea Project that might run for 4 weeks? You could stretch it out, so you're not having to do this double duty. How can I package it so I can go in, and the reason it's hyper, it's live, you can alter it and edit it and add to it based on, wow, the kids took it in a different direction. And so I'm kind of talking to teachers about making maybe for novels or for their history lessons or their science lessons to start there. To think about it that way.
Especially because by starting small like that, I can now foster the communication piece around it, which is what makes it so powerful.
Yes. Yeah.
And so I think that's a great idea.
Sarah brings up another good point.
Yeah, Sarah, she's got all the good ideas.
Of course she's going to be smart.
You probably met her, Holly, and she's from the UK.
And Holly, we were talking about you the other day because we have a hashtag called Clarktastic.
So
we were saying that Holly needs to be part of our Clarktastic.
With the assignments feature, and I hope I have this right, but you could assign, because you know how you bring it into assignments and then you assign to certain kids. So what I have done in the past in my Google Classroom is just that. Like, I have the HyperDoc looks exactly the same. So the kid's like walking around with his HyperDoc, but this kid has kind of a different one. And this kid has a different reading assignment because they need a different level. And maybe I'm using like Newsela to give them a different reading level. And so you could do that in the assignments feature, like give to these kids this one and give to these kids that one too as well. So that's smart.
I love that. Even if you make it like some of it open-ended too, where the students could then even put their thoughts into it and turn it right back into you. Yes. So it makes it much faster to get that reply and less work for them to jump around circles. So
I want to do two tips of it or two things of, is Mike the one who did that? Because it says whales. Is he the one that did that, too long IR? TLIR. Do you remember that?
Yes, I think so.
TLDR. TLDR, right?
Too long. TLDR, but now it's TL. No, that was Chris. Chris Gerard. Yeah. But Mike was probably in the conversation. He did a lot of great tweets.
Anyway, so two things that have happened to me while I'm coaching teachers is that people tell me all the time, oh yeah, I know what a HyperDoc is. And then I get into their classroom and they know what a doc with links is. And so I think, you know, I do the slight, you know, what if we did this? But I also find that I have teachers who go, I went to teachers, paid teachers, and I don't like any of this. And they're really not for you. They're for you to use to get inspiration and to bring in, like Lisa said, your own ideas. So just remember that as you go exploring that, they're probably not for you. And we have had this kind of culture of, let's say Lisa makes, and she's made that the one on a good idea. If I take it and make it my own, I just say, inspired by Lisa Heifel. Mm-hmm. You know? So we start this culture of sharing. Mm-hmm.
That's what it's all about. We have to learn from each other and give credit to each other and support each other and just keep growing. So that's what's so amazing about this community. And I know with the Microsoft community, that's one thing that we have just loved, you know, the family. And we talk about that all the time. Like, we truly is a family and everyone is so supportive of each other. And it's just, I mean, I don't know. That's where we learn everything. It's just, you have a question, you can just reach out and they're always there to help.
And Holly, I think that's such great advice because a lot of times when we go out and look for things, we very rarely find something that's customized just right for us. Like, we're always tweaking and fixing and just remember that, because that is part of being a teacher, is customizing it for your students. You know what they need. And so you have to take content and customize it.
Equate it to cooking. And if you follow me on Instagram, you saw my soup wars all winter. I find soup recipes and then, heaven forbid, I follow the recipe. I never can, because I always have to add and adjust to my taste or to allergies. And lesson design is the same way. And so you can't expect to go and download something and be just handed out to your kids. That's not what these are, unless you want that. If that's what you want, that's not what HyperDocs are. So it's up for you to fix. We just started it for you. So
as I peek in here to the Microsoft world and everything, I'm coming in as I peek in and I'm having a HyperDoc in hand saying, come look. So that's all you'll see me playing in this new world.
That's some great comments. And this is Celie's mom. So we had our moms on the show. If you guys saw on Monday, we did a little Mother's Day tribute.
Nice.
Tommy is in here. We appreciate she's a former a former principal. And so we'll get to talk with her later and hear her thoughts.
Oh, yeah. But I think we're doing dinner tonight. So I'm sure she's going to be
I'd love to hear from you, Mike. This would be great. So I talk a lot on Twitter at L Highfield, and I'm also in the Facebook group chatting away. That's a good way to catch me. And so I need to learn from all of you too. I really do. So if I talk, you can correct my language of how to share things, how to make copies, how to edit, revise, you know.
Well, you know, Lisa, Jenny and I are actually right now working on a presentation for our upcoming TCEA for TOTS, or Elementary TCEA conference. And we are doing learning menus or choice boards.
Yes.
And I'm like, oh my goodness, this is like transforming the way I think about how we do learning menus. Oh. Essentially, I'm creating a HyperDoc learning menu. Like, I can't wait.
I think, like, one has pedagogy and one's like kind of, they're different.
Well, yeah, a multimedia tech set can be considered a learning menu, mm-hmm. you know, or a choice board. Those are other names. I came across them, well, gosh, in 2011, multimedia tech set. Someone had already written the book on that one. So, and I thought they were brilliant. I just needed to take them further than the explore portion, but there's a place for them for sure.
Yeah, absolutely.
To teach kids how to explore, how to be curious. That's huge. Yeah.
And I also on hollyclark.org am going all in on Microsoft and HyperDoc. So I'll be there a lot doing stuff. So ask away. Questions.
Yay.
So much good stuff. I know Flea and I are going to be diving in, and I'm going to maybe, since my husband is out of town for the next few days, I'm going to have this be my nighttime reading and sit and kind of just go through this a little bit more too, because you've definitely inspired us, and we are ready to learn and create and dive into the resources that you've shared. So, so excited, and we appreciate you guys so much. Definitely check out the Microsoft Infused Classroom and the HyperDoc Handbook. So I'm sure you can find them on Amazon, and would be a great resource and for any educator, anybody right now, especially as we're all in this design process and we have the summer coming up. I mean, this is a great time to just try something new, you know, try something different. And, you know, I love that lesson cycle. Like that really, I think, was what really hit me was, it's like Flea said, it's not just a document of links. Like there is truly a lesson to this and behind it. There's some meat to it. So that's exciting.
Can't wait. Yay.
Microsoft is going to go HyperDoc.
We love it. We love it. Well, thank you, ladies, so much. You have been so inspiring. We appreciate all that you do, and for the Google world and the Microsoft world. And, you know, like we say, we are all better together. So you have given us so much to think about, and we appreciate you spending the afternoon with us. And next week, I think on Monday, right? Yes, Monday, we have the Merrill. So they're going to be with us on Monday afternoon, and they're going to be sharing all the amazing things they do with Flipgrid. I'm sure they'll go off on some other things too, but they are just, you know, just leaders in, with Flipgrid, and they also have an amazing book out, the Interactive Class, so we can't wait to hear from them as well. So join us Monday afternoon at 4:15 Central Time to hear from the Merrill. So we thank you, and we're going to end with our slogan. Yes. So go and be a
different kind of awesome.
Bye.
Thank you.
I saw them move the meeting to 7 tonight. Is that